Leon Draisaitl's hit on Sasha Barkov, who plays an immensely crucial role for the Florida Panthers. He's a guy I think wins the Selke as long as he's a competitive hockey player in this league. He's the best defensive centerman in the league, and he's the guy whose job it is to slow down Connor McDavid, who had 1 point in the first two games. Maybe the most important Panther. He's right there with Bobrovsky for sure. Draisaitl's frustrated. It's late. They're down 2-1 at that point, about 9 minutes left. What do you make of this hit where Draisaitl does leave his feet, does go directly into the face area of Barkov, not into the body?
I mean, when you first saw it, this angle from behind the glass is a little bit more telling where his arm, I mean, he doesn't hit him with the shoulder. He does kind of the front one where you kind of tuck your arms in and you go and you do follow through. But I mean, look at Barkov going back into the D zone with all kinds of pressure behind him. And he just hits the brakes and goes right back against the grain, exposes his whole head right to the thing. And, you know, Draisaitl goes and finishes him, but he doesn't even fall down from the hit. I see so many other hits that were so much more aggressive than that one. One by Bennett in the corner on, I think it was Bouchard, just crushes his head and blows him up in the corner. Nothing. There was lots of violent, aggressive hits throughout the whole playoffs and this series in particular, Florida Panthers as well. That is no big deal. But I'm telling you, if Barkov doesn't lay on the ice, we aren't even looking at that play.
Listen, we've talked about it, right or wrong. When the Department of Player Safety looks at a hit, a guy being done for the year, a guy playing the next shift, or a guy going to miss a month, that's part of their formula. And to be fair, it's a nothing hit if everyone's fine, because everyone's fine. And it is not fair to leave your feet, have the side of your elbow contact a player in the jaw area if that's the most important skater they have. I'm sorry. Like, you have to incorporate some of that. It can't be everything.
To me, it's irrelevant how important player is. Hit a fourth liner and get fucking nothing, but you hit their star and not, you get suspended.
It's not about star versus fourth liner. It's about broken jaw versus skate away.
Is his jaw broken? Or is he playing?
I think he's playing, but the Panthers weren't ready to say it wasn't broken after the game.
Let's say he's absolutely fine and putting on a performance and you suspend Leon Draisaitl.
You don't.
You got to wait to see if he's playing or not.
Well, Department of Player Safety is going to take their sweet time because they can. Mm-hmm. And the moment you make Barkov eligible to play game three, you're like, yeah, we're not suspending you. But if Barkov's done for the series, you can't not suspend the guy. If it's a broken jaw, Jay?
Yeah, I know what you're saying. I get what you're saying, but the hit didn't warrant a broken jaw. He didn't break the rules to the point of a broken jaw. Like I said, you know, pull up the Bennett hit where that could have been a concussion, a broken jaw, teeth gone, and it just wasn't.
Yeah.
So that's okay now. But it's just, you're sitting there and waiting to see, hold on, is he hurt or not? Oh, suspend him right now. Oh, he's okay. He's going to play. No, you're fine. Go continue on as business as usual. I just don't like that. Like, here's a hit. Bouchard comes in, doesn't even have the puck. Boom, right to his head. And no, nothing, because he pops up. He doesn't lay there and fucking take 3 days to decide if he's okay or not. He gets up and plays, so nothing happens. Yeah. So I understand he caught a piece of his head. Maybe his jaw's cracked. If he's out, it's detrimental to the Florida Panthers. Right, I just hate going down the road of, we're going to suspend based on how important the player is to the team and whether it resulted in injury or not.
Yeah, and the challenge I pose to Oilers fans, because you're hearing a lot about it, is like, if you're okay with that, then you're okay with Bennett doing that to McDavid. Mm-hmm. And that's the game you're going to play. And look, if you want to get into that game, the Panthers are going to beat you. That's what they're best at. They're greasiest. They're masters of the dark arts. We've sat here week after week after week pointing out how they walk the line better than anyone. The ninja punch Bennett lands on Marchand that basically takes him out of the series until it's too late. I mean,
if you want to
let that be clean, don't get me wrong. It'll help the Oilers that game, but the Panthers now just have everything swing into their favor. If that's where the standard's going to be, the Panthers have even more leverage in the series.
So talk about Bennett's, you know, phantom sucker punch to Brad Marchand, the captain, the soul of the Boston Bruins. He's out of the series. Marchand missed the majority of the series after that. I think he came back for the final game, but they had all kinds of time to suspend Sam Bennett. They knew Marchand wasn't going to play. They saw the view of it. They had the video. They didn't do it.
See, and that's what I wonder, because the game camera, you didn't see shit. And you're like, boy, that's weird. Like, what happened there? And then we didn't see the reverse angle.
It was
like
the next morning that I saw it. So if the NHL can't keep up to me, you have a problem. I can barely run my iPhone.
So if it was the next day, that's fine.
And there's, what about some of the hits at the beginning of the series where a guy doesn't even have the puck, hasn't even touched it. Kaboom, cripples him in the neutral zone. Like if we're talking about suspensions right now, and we're talking about that little Leon Draisaitl, little run, give you finish my check hard on you. That's insane. Just that Barkov laid there.
And all I'm saying is you don't suspend that at all unless Barkov's done.
I know.
That sucks because you don't want to have that as part of the equation because it entices guys to lie down. But to be fair, if Barkov's done for the series, you can't let that be okay. And if he's fine, we move along and everyone plays. And
That's the most likely scenario too. I get my back up when it's like, why does Leon have to miss the game because of an unfortunate, like,
It is unfortunate. It is an elbow.
It is on his jaw. And if he gets hurt, I get it. It's just, again, it's such an innocent hit compared to so many other things.
Yeah.
I just don't like going down the road of let's wait and see if he's okay. Like you can like look at some of the things, Trouba and some of the things guys are doing out there that we could have talked about and dissected, but we're choosing this little thing where the guy didn't even leave his feet. He just kind of got smushed. It's like, okay, let's suspend Leon, but just because it's Barkov, and I think it's going to solve itself. Barkov's going to be fine.
Yeah, I agree.
Not going to be an issue, but yeah, it becomes that talking point of, I guess, does that make the most sense? If he's hurt, then we'll suspend.
Well, it's, yeah. And look, this is, we've always talked about it. It's, if you say we can't allow the outcome to affect the suspension, I could bring up a bunch of examples where you're like, well, yeah, shit, you're kind of right there. But if you're like, well, it's not the act that matters, it's only the outcome. Well, that doesn't work either. Like there just isn't an easy way to do this job. And that's why everyone thinks Department of Player Safety sucks. And no one's like, you know, did that job really well? That guy. No, everyone sucks at it. It's just like a fishing. It's too hard.
I haven't minded Peros at this game.
I honestly, this year, there really haven't been that many ones where you're not, like it all ends up kind of where you thought it would.
And they,
the empty net thing was a Morgan Riley. Like, I think he said in person and you're like, oh, that's, but it was just 5 on the nose, I think. And you're like, that's not crazy. Maybe it's a 3 somewhere else, whatever.
That's after a game cross check, which I don't think they took into effect. It started on the shoulder and came up to the head, but yeah, just a blatant cross check to the
head
as
a weapon
after the game, because you're literally just didn't like what he did.
All of them have been fine.
I didn't come down too hard on that suspension. You knew he was going to get it, but was it worth it? Was the big question. But yeah, it's not a perfect science. There's tons of gray area. Mm-hmm. There's tons of external factors you can look at. And I think, you know, you got to give credit where credit's due. They've done a pretty good job so far, mostly because they err on the side of let it be.
Yeah. And you watch, there's been, I believe, 7 power plays for the Oilers for 2 games. They haven't scored on it, which is odd. The whistles do go away. It's not for the playoffs. It's the later you get into every series, the less the referees want to affect, you know, we don't want to affect game 1, but game 2, but well, by the time you get to games 5, 6, and 7, it's like, you have to take a full ass baseball swing on someone to get a call against you here.
Rightfully so. That's why we love it, man. It's a very, very intense,
but
rugged,
again,
aggressive game.
There's your line. It's always moving. Yep, players just want consistency. It was like, it doesn't exist. Like game 7 overtime, what would you have to do to get a penalty called?
Fuck, you should have to do a lot.
Yeah, I mean, like, I agree, but then all we want is the standards. Like, well, the standard changes when it gets to game 7 and when it gets to overtime,
and everybody knows it too. You want to walk that line and get close and do something that would normally be a penalty. It doesn't matter what the, you know, understanding or unwritten rule is. If that ref's arm goes up, you are in trouble. So you're flirting with
high stakes.
You're flirting with it no matter what.